Diane Wirth is the professor, Richard Pearson Strong, professor of infectious diseases at Harvard School of Public Health. She's a longtime friend of DNDi, an original member of the Drugs for Neglected Diseases Working Group, and if I'm not mistaken, the first chair of our Scientific Advisory Committee. It's a great honor to introduce Diane Wirth.
Well, thank you, Rachel, and it is indeed a pleasure to be here. And if I could ask the first panel to come and take your seats at the table. And while they're doing that, I just wanted to reflect, you know, it is almost exactly a decade since we began this discussion of the need for applying the best science to the most neglected diseases. And I think you'll see, both throughout the conference and evidenced by Tony Fauci's comments, that indeed there has been some progress. But I think we all realize now, perhaps not as much as we realized then, that this is a long process requiring continued commitment, not just in developing new tools, but also in implementing those tools. And I think what we're going to try to do today is by focusing on with our distinguished panel, focusing on a few examples of where there are problems, where there has been progress, and what are kind of the next steps that we need to take. And what I would say is, a decade ago, there was no discussion or very limited discussion of making differences in the neglected diseases that are the focus of this effort. And today, we're talking about how we can do better. So we've made progress, but there's a long way to go. So because we've run a little bit behind time, we're going to go ahead and start with the panelists. So we have a panelist, a presenter, and then a discussant on each of the three topics. So I'm going to introduce the first of our presenters, Dr. Mark Gusto Etgori. He is the International Medical Secretary of Medicine Sans Frontières, MSF, where he aims to strengthen medical innovation and policy within MSF. And he's going to talk about the urgent need for new tools for DRTB.
Well, thank you very much. I would like as well to thank the Mount Sinai Hospital. Thank you very much. Thanks for DNDi and thanks for MSF, of course. And I'm going now to give a speech regarding MDR-TB. And well, in fact, I would like to explain why MDR-TB is an emergency. I will try to first to get a general picture, going to an individual picture of this disease. And I will, at the end of this presentation, try to explain and to answer to this question, why is it an emergency? So what we can say regarding first tuberculosis is that it's one of the first serial killers in the world. Yeah. We just think that there will be around 14 million deaths within the next decade, and 1 million of people now are living with a multi-drug-resistant tuberculosis, of whom around, and maybe less, have access to diagnosis, and of whom less have an access to a treatment, of whom less have an access to a cure treatment. As you can see, the crisis is quite huge, and of course, we need to go forward. MSF is working on this disease since a long time. But we can say that our results are far from being very good. In 2011, we treated 26,000 people with TB in 39 countries. In 2011, we treated 1,300 people for MDR-TB in 21 countries. Now, we have outcomes from DRTB treatments for 5 seats over 10 years. So from 2001 to 2010, MSF treatment outcomes from around 1,100 people with confirmed MDR-TB in Abkhazia, Armenia, I'm sorry, but I have difficulties, Karakal, Pakistan, Kenya, and Swaziland, show 53% overall success rate regarding MDR-TB. Regarding XDR-TB, I have some difficulties in explaining that this is a 13% success rate. 13 is correct, of course, but success rate is not the right word we should use for such a percentage. We need to scale up. And how do we have to do that? How do we move? And here, as well, I'm going to get back with some ideas which are quite simple and which were presented by the former speaker, but they are very important to mention. First of all, we have to look at the situation of patients. Well, what happens? Around 60% roughly of the patients will have an access to a peripheral health clinic. That's definitively not a lot. Of the 60% of patients, some will go to a biological diagnosis. We can guess that roughly around 25% will have an access to a biological diagnosis. And 5% only will have an access to drug sensitivity testing. Well, the situation is quite impressive, and when we look and when we compare it with HIV, where we have now point of care diagnosis, we can see that there is a real room for improvement regarding this situation. Regarding diagnosis, and this is a very important tool, of course, we can say that GeneXpert, which has been described already, represents a very important advance. Why? Because it increases the number of lab-confirmed TB diagnoses. But mainly, it accelerates the time for DRTB diagnosis. And of course, it accelerates the treatment initiation. We calculated that the advantage, the gain, is around between 60 days and 2 weeks, which is, of course, a very important benefit. It increases the number of detected cases, and it is cost-effective. Even if the cost is quite expensive, around $10 per test, we can see that the preliminary results of an MSF study in Zimbabwe showed this cost effectiveness. One of the side effects which will appear, and I insist on that point just now, is that taking this diagnosis at the field level will, of course, increase the number of detection of MDR-TB, which means that the percentage will automatically rise in the coming years if we use this test on the field. But this test is not perfect. It presents as well a lot of shortcomings. So we can say that first, it is still not a point of care technology, and it is not easily available for resource-limited settings. Its implementation requires a substantial logistical and financial investment. We still need for better tests for pediatric TB diagnosis, which is still a very important challenge regarding diagnostics of TB. Now, if we look at the treatments are old. The last approved new drugs was 50 years ago. It's long. It takes 2 years. 2 years means 720 days where you have to take the pills. It's more than a marathon. It's complex, multiple tablets, 8 months of injectable agents. It needs tailored to individual resistance patterns. And it's very hard to scale up. Once again, if you look at your success rate, as it's called, and the difficulties, it's difficult. We have a lot of difficulties to scale up on the field. It's expensive. It can be more than $4,500 as a drug cost. It's inadequate. We have a high default rate, low cure rate, and it generates further resistance. And further resistance as well means further transmission, which means a general and a global threat. These treatments are unproven. We did not get any randomized clinical trial or prospective trial for the current regimens. Here, at that point, I would like to go on patient perspective, which is, of course, the most important perspective we have. And I would like to quote Mrs. Fumeza, who is 20 years old and who has been diagnosed with XDR-TB in June 2010 in the CAP. I'm going to quote her directly. What she said is, this is a hell with TB. I have had enough. If you try to make it nice instead of saying it straight, people easily ignore it. It took my hearing away. Now it wants to take my life. Well, Fumeza is going better. She's improving, but she's one of the rare patients who is improving among the patients we are treating. What do we need, and what should we criticize? Well, of course, now the treatment models are on over-reliance on hospitalization. We need to move towards a decentralization and a patient-centered approach. We need individualization of treatments, and of course, this is a challenge for programmatic scale-up. We need a political will. We have too few patients treated. We do not have enough research and development. We have insufficient means. There is a funding gap of 94 million in high burden countries, which is expected in 2012. Of course, the question here, but this is only one of the questions, is how can we scale up with a lack of funds? Where do we want to go? What's the way forward now? Well, I'm going to repeat very basic things, but they are essential for the life of a lot of our patients, as I have stated it. We need more robust technology. We need a decentralized setting at the point of care, at the level of the health post, at the level of mobile clinic. We need to aim to a non-sputum-based test, and we need a drastic improvement of TB detection in kids. To go forward, we need quality drugs to consolidate the market. Regarding compassionate treatment, they have to be implemented as soon as possible. This is an emergency for thousands of patients. We need the immediate use of new molecules while waiting for registration. We don't have to waste time regarding that. Our patients are dying. We need to push for rapid development of regimens with better outcomes and a shorter duration. And this will allow a scale-up, and we will be able to treat more patients with that. We need to decentralize care. We need to push for inclusion of children in new drugs and regimen development. The way forward is past with hope by now. We have mentioned it. There are quite a lot of improvements. They are not sufficient, but we have improvement. We have improvement in diagnosis. We have improvement in the pipelines for new drugs. We know that two new compounds have been submitted for registration. They are expected quite soon. This is an emergency to incorporate them in new drugs and regimens, to incorporate them in clinical trials, and to assure sustainability and availability of these drugs, but of course of research and development as well. Scale-up cannot be ignored, and this is something which is obvious. Well, I promise to answer to the question of why is it an emergency? An emergency is a situation which requires a prompt action. By now, we think that we know and medical doctors, but not only medical doctors, know that there are four pillars for a success in a specific disease, which are diagnosis, it's improving, which are treatments, we hope that it will improve quite soon, which are funds, we hope, of course, that the funds will come, and I will allow myself to make a remark for the former speaker, we need as well a political will. Without political will, we will not get policies. Without policies, we will not get priorities, and we will not get a proper implementation on the field in order to scale up the treatment and in order to treat our patients and to save them, and to transform, once again, what is by now a death sentence in a hope to live. Well, I hope that I explained what is an emergency, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Now we'll have a discussion of this topic by Dr. Atajan Karimovich Kamrev. He was the Vice Chairman of the Supreme Assembly of the Autonomous Republic of Karakal Pakstan. He will be speaking in Russian. His slides will be in English. And you all have these units for translation.
Good morning. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues. I would also like to say that I'm very glad to be here and would like to express my gratitude to the organizers of the conference. I am thankful to you all for giving sufficient attention to the scourges of our time, such as TB and other neglected diseases. The region I represent, Karakalpakian, is located in Kazakhstan. Our population is 1.7 million people. I'm a member of parliament of our republic and vice chairman of the Supreme Assembly of the republic. The reason I mentioned TB as a scourge is that in my country, this is still one of the important health problems, which is partially due to the oral crisis. You are probably aware of the fact that we used to have a sea called the Aral Sea, but due to the effect of many anthropogenic factors, it is now disappearing. In other words, its total area has reduced 10 times over, and this has many negative environmental impacts, which are easily translated into social problems. That is drought, that is insufficient amount of drinking water, and we immediately saw such an effect as an increase of TB. The red line here shows the incidence of TB in Karakalpakstan over the past 40 years. Blue line shows the mean incidence rate in Uzbekistan as a whole. In other words, the area where we live are twice as high as in the rest of the region, that is Uzbekistan. And I believe I've just explained the reason why. The significant environmental crisis, further exacerbated by the economic problems following the collapse of the Soviet Union. What is especially worrisome is prevalence of multi-drug resistant TB. The rates are continuously growing, 13% new cases in 2001. By 2010, the rate has grown more than two times. In light of this problem, the TB problem, Uzbekistan government adopted a governmental program to do additional work to fight TB in the country with certain goals established set by 2015. The program includes all aspects of working with TB, including R&D, personnel training, and providing necessary treatment courses. Starting in 1992, we decided to treat the environmental problems and the TB problems as one single problem, and we are cooperating with Médecins Sans Frontières, and we've accomplished certain significant results organizationally between 1998 and until 2003. We implemented the initial strategy, providing a therapy, and in 2010 we started increasing coverage and started giving more attention to multi-drug resistant TB. In February 2011, we started treatment of these patients with drug-resistant TB in outpatient settings. at this point in time, we're developing protocols, and in January 2013, we hope to start treating patients with shorter therapies. And these slides show treatment coverage under the DOT program, including multidrug-resistant TB. The coverage, as you can see from here, is more than 3,700 patients, including a high percentage of those with drug-resistant tuberculosis. The effectiveness of drugs, as it has been mentioned before me, is not particularly high, but we believe it is satisfactory. The death rate has gone down, the number of adverse effects have gone down, but unfortunately, the overall results are not that impressive. What we show in this slide is outpatient treatment administered from the first day after the diagnosis of the disease. Again, there are two lines in this slide. The yellow line shows multi-resistant forms, the red line for non-multidrug resistant TB. Only 4% of patients were treated in outpatient setting. In the beginning, by the end of the program, we got to 60% of patients treated in outpatient settings. Here we compare the rates of effectiveness for drugs for treatment of multidrug-resistant tuberculosis in outpatient setting. That is when from the first day of the diagnosis, instead of placing a patient in the hospital, they are treated in outpatient conditions. As you can see, the death rate is lower here. And what is important is that the rate of patients developing resistance to drugs is lower for patients treated in outpatient settings. Here again, we have a comparison between outpatient and hospital settings. We cannot give you the final results yet because we started this program quite recently, but we can compare what we have so far in terms of death rates, in terms of developing resistance to drugs. You can see here that in outpatient settings, these numbers are lower than in hospital settings. We are facing quite a number of challenges, and many of them are very urgent. One of them is a very high rate of incompliance. Unfortunately, very often patients fail to do what is required, especially when they experience a certain improvement after 8 or 9 months of effective treatment. We decided to analyze this situation, and we found that 494 patients who were receiving treatment had 858 treatment interruptions, which, of course, is a factor conducive to developing drug resistance. This is not a satisfactory situation, and it needs to be changed. There are certain other drawbacks, such as that the existing treatment is very toxic, very lengthy, and very often not satisfactory for patients or physicians. All of this needs us to perfect treatment as far as multidrug-resistant TB is concerned, using new drugs and new methods of treatment. What we would like to suggest here is we would like to emphasize our need for treatment with new drugs, and we are very proud of certain capacity that we have in terms of diagnostics. We are equipped with everything necessary. We have gene experts, and we are adapting many methods developed elsewhere. Methods based on what Médecins Sans Frontières is doing together with us. We are training our local personnel and working together with international specialists. We are proud of our information base, which includes all information about patients, including adversary events. We have a well-established network of inpatient and outpatient clinics, as well as a system of social work with patients, because we really want to help them, especially those patients who suffer from drug-resistant tuberculosis. And we are very willing to implement innovations. As I said before, the main idea here is to open access for our patients to new drugs and new methods of treatment.
Большое спасибо. Вы привели замечательный пример страны, которая борется с такими важными проблемами в области туберкулеза. У нас будет
возможность. We have a presenter and then a discussant. Our presenter is Dr. Julio Urbina, who is with the Venezuelan Institute of Scientific Research. His own research is in researching neglected disease, the Chagas of Chagas, but also he's an expert in drug discovery and development, and has been associated with DNDi, I think, since its inception. So, Julio.
Good morning. Thank you very much, Diane. It's a pleasure for me to be here. Congratulations, of course, to Médecins Sans Frontières and DNDi for this fantastic decade. I want to thank the organizers of the meeting, particularly Bernard Pécoul, for his kind invitation to be here. I mean, it's also a pleasure to share this session with Diane Wirth, with whom I spent many enjoyable and very productive times at the Scientific Advisory Committee of DNDi. Okay, so here's the title of the talk: Reaching Neglected Patients with Chagas Disease, Treatment, Challenges, Progresses, and Shortcomings. It was prepared according to the request of the organizers. I consider treatment, etiological treatment, of course, not in isolation and as only one element among the different elements that are required to manage this complex condition, and the others being, of course, prevention and an understanding of the pathogenesis of this disease, which is essential for the quality of life of the patients. I'm going to talk about some basic things about Chagas disease. Many of you know about it, but there are some specific complexities of this condition, which is a challenge both as a biomedical and as a socio-economical phenomenon. This is a systemic parasitosis caused by the kinotoblastic protozoan T. cruzii. It's highly prevalent among autochthonous mammals of the American continent, the parasite being transmitted by Haematophagus reduvid insects. It's really not a human, exclusively human disease. It's a zoonosis, really, and you have to keep that in mind. Human disease results from the invasion of natural ecotopes, as well from the establishment of the vectors in human dwellings due to the poor socioeconomic conditions that are prevailing in the rural zones from Mexico to Argentina, which are the endemic regions. The infection can also be acquired by blood transfusions, congenital infections, and by oral route. The disease has a short, frequently asymptomatic acute phase, followed by a lifelong, this is a disease for life, chronic condition that in over 30 to 40% of cases results in severe physiopathological alterations of the heart or GI tract. And those manifestations, when they appear, they are invariably fatal if not untreated. It is important to point out that the pathogenesis of the disease in the prevailing chronic phase has been the focus of a strong scientific controversies. And this has limited the management of the patients in this chronic phase. I'm going to talk about that later. A specific treatment of Chagas disease is currently based on two drugs, basically, the 2-nitrofuran nifurtimox and a 5-nitrimidazole benznidazole. They were developed empirically in the 60s and 70s. They are active in the acute phase from 95%+ in newborns to 60% in adolescents, but the efficacy varies depending on the endemic area, probably resulting from the natural drug resistance of the circulating strains. However, the big problem with this is, there are two big problems with these two drugs. One is that they are significantly less active in the chronic phase, which is, as I said, the stage in which most patients, more than 90% patients are currently. And the fact in the other problem is that because of the mechanism of action, they are basically prodrugs that are transformed into free radical, nitro radicals in the body. They have frequent deleterious side effects, and 10 to 20% of cases have to be have to be discontinued. We have to add here that on top of the limitation of the treatment, and despite many efforts, there are no vaccines available for this disease. And we have to keep in mind, because of its zoonosis, Chagas disease cannot be eradicated. That's the different, completely different from other diseases, human diseases like malaria or smallpox, which theoretically you could eliminate the disease from if you cure every. But in this case, Trypanosoma cruzi is part of Mother Nature, and it's going to be there always. Okay, although this disease has afflicted humans since the earliest presence in the New World, it remains today the parasitic disease which has the largest socioeconomic impact in Latin America. $1 to $1.5 billion per year are lost due to the limitations in the life of those patients. Okay, concerning progress, there has been some significant progress in the last 10, 15 years. The vector control multinational initiatives in terms of prevention, such as the Southern Initiative and the Central American Countries Initiative, have led to great advances in the control of vectorial transmission in large areas of American continent. As a result of those, Uruguay, Chile, and Brazil today, as well as substantial parts of Argentina, Bolivia, and Paraguay, are currently free of transmission by domiciliary triatomic infectants. This was possible because this vector is strictly domiciliary. So if you eliminate the populations in the houses, there is no reinfection. Also, by 2010, the transmission in Central America by the non-autochthonous Rhodnius prolixum vector, which actually was imported by accident from Venezuela, was eliminated in Guatemala, Mexico, El Salvador, and Costa Rica, and there are no reports in Honduras since 2011. Medicines and Frontier and the JICA, the Japanese International Cooperation Agency, plays a very important role in those successful campaigns. Control of transfusional transmission by a screening of anti-tricruci antibody, it has achieved a very large 98 to 100% coverage in most endemic countries by the last decade. And as a combination of all those efforts, such advances have led to a reduction in the prevalence from 16 to 18 million to 10 million today, and the population at risk dropped from 90 to 100 million to 40 million today. There are also other important progress concerning the understanding of the pathogenesis of the disease. That's what I was saying before about the controversies. Although everybody agrees that the parasite has a fundamental role in the acute phase of the disease, for a long time there was a big controversy on what was the pathogenesis of the chronic stage. An early work implicated autoimmune phenomena in the pathogenesis of chronic disease. According to that hypothesis, after the autoimmune response, which is triggered by the initial infection of the parasite, is established, even successful antiparasitic intervention would enable to stop the progression of the disease. This notion indicated that this disease was incurable. I mean, chronic Chagas disease was incurable. And this prevailed for many years, for decades, and this led to two very important consequences. One is that most patients, the chronic patients, were excluded from treatment because it was considered irrelevant. And secondly, this stalled the development of new drugs because, again, it was considered useless. However, more recent studies have shown that the persistence of parasites coupled with an unbalanced immune response, which can include some autoimmune reaction, is necessary and sufficient for the generating the sustained inflammatory response that in infected tissues that leads to the characteristic lesions of the chronic stage. And so it can be inferred from these recent results that is the elimination of cruciate from infected patients might be a prerequisite to arrest the evolution of the disease and to avert its irreversible long terms. So the current consensus, and this is a very important paradigm change, is that these conditions have to be treated as a parasitic disease, not an autoimmune disease, and that all patients, all seropositive patients, should be treated. I repeat, this is a very important and very recent change in the scientific paradigm of this disease, because until the last decade of last century, it was considered as an incurable autoimmune disease. So this imposed a lot of pressure on developing new drugs, of course. So there has been progress also in the development of new drugs. There is a benefit trial for the evaluation of the clinical and parasitological efficacy of benidazole in chronic Chagas disease. This started in 2004, and we expect the results in a couple of years. DNDi established the first ever Chagas disease platform for drug development platform, founded in 2009. Also, DNDi contributed together with the laboratory the Pharmaceutical of Pernambuco in Brazil to the development of a pediatric formulation of benidazole. And there are also three clinical trials with ergosterol biosynthesis inhibitors, particularly inhibitors of CYP51, the C14 esterol demethylases, which those compounds were shown beginning in the 90s to be able to cure both acute and chronic Chagas disease in experimental animals. And now there are two trials, one phase two in Vall d'Hebron Hospital in Barcelona and another one in Argentina and Colombia. The first one is already finished. They are processing data. And the other one is still ongoing. Ravuconazole is a second potential drug that is being developed for with the NDI and A-side. And amiodarone, the most frequently used antiarrhythmic drug, has also been shown to be effective against Trypanosoma cruzii. There are other candidates which inhibitors and cystine protease, fexinidazole, and nitrimidazole, which is currently ongoing trials as a drug against African trypanosomiasis, other CYP51 inhibitors. Combination therapies are also being considered the possibility in the future. So are we going with time?
Time.
Okay. Okay. So I would like to finish saying that there has been a very significant advances in this field, but still we remain with the necessity of sustaining those efforts, both in the process of preventing the disease and in the process of sustaining drug development efforts. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I think a really clear example where, you know, basic science has changed our view, and this is an example of a chronic, you know, so this interface between chronic and infectious diseases. So our discussant is Peter Hotez, and Peter is the dean of the National School of Tropical Medicine at the Baylor College of Medicine. Peter is an expert in tropical diseases, doing his early work in hookworm, but has now expanded his remit to include neglected tropical diseases overall, and he's one of the major spokesmen for this area in the U.S.
Thank you very much, Diane, for those comments, and I really do want to congratulate MSF and DNDi for not only this conference, but for an incredible track record of success, not only for product development, but as advocates for the world's poor. I'm hearing an echo here. I don't know if there's any way to just ignore it. Sounds like the what I used to remember from watching The Exorcist in high school, and you hear these little voices in the background all of the time. Hopefully my head won't start swiveling. I'd like to say a few non-obvious things about the presentation. It was a beautiful presentation, and I congratulate you for that, Professor Urbina. One of the things that I'd like to draw attention to is that not many people talk about when they talk about Chagas disease is this as a problem of girls and women. We have some estimates to suggest that there may be as many as 300,000 pregnant women in Latin America infected with Trypanosoma cruzi who have Chagas disease. By some estimates, 1 in 10 pregnant women with Chagas disease. Do you know what we have to offer a pregnant woman with Chagas disease right now? That's right, absolutely nothing. None of the drugs are available to treat during pregnancy, and the reason it's so important is not only for the adverse health impact on the mother, but also we know now between 1 in 10 and 1 in 20 women will pass that infection onto the unborn fetus to produce congenital Chagas disease, which is a very severe problem. So I think we need to give particular attention to this problem of Chagas disease in pregnancy, Chagas disease among girls and women. We also have an important problem of the fact that this is not only in the poorest countries in South America and Central America. We have, by some estimates, 40,000 pregnant women in North America with Chagas disease as well, and some estimates 2,000 cases of congenital Chagas disease. This is not an uncommon situation. So let's look at North America for a minute. We've been working with DNDi and MSF and others and have some estimates to suggest that up to 7 million people in North America are infected with Trypanosoma cruzi with Chagas disease. What we really don't know, and the reason we don't know, is this disease has been profoundly neglected both in Mexico and the United States, so that there's virtually no active surveillance being undertaken. Some suggestions through our colleague Dr. Reyes that between 2 to 6 million people in Mexico have Chagas disease, but as you can imagine, that's a big spread between 2 or 6 million. And an additional problem is most of those 2 to 6 million have no access to essential medicines for Chagas disease, neither benznidazole nor nifurtimox. And so this, to me, is an incredible tragedy going on in Mexico. But we also have an equally important tragedy in the United States. Chagas disease is a disease of poverty, and it's a surprise to many, but we have poor people in the United States. Anybody know how many poor people we have in the United States? 60%. Very good. The number says that 15% live below the poverty level. But beyond that, we have the situation of extreme poverty in the United States, and maybe an unprecedented level of extreme poverty in the United States. 20 million people living in extreme poverty, meaning more than one standard deviation below the poverty line. And now the new numbers out of the University of Michigan suggest that we have 1.46 million families, about almost 5 million people, who live on less than $2 a day. So for the first time, we can apply the same global benchmark for poverty that we might see in low and middle income countries to the United States. And with this, we have an important problem in Chagas disease, especially in the state where I work in Texas, where we have 1 in 5 Texans living below the poverty line, around 5 million people. Some estimates suggest that there's 300,000 cases of Chagas disease, but other estimates suggest that there's 267,000 cases of Chagas disease in Texas alone. Now, when we think about Chagas disease in Texas, we often think, well, this must be a problem of immigration, right? People are coming up from Mexico, El Salvador, and that may be an important component. But we have now 8% of the dogs in Texas, in South Texas, infected with Trypanosoma cruzi. Guess what? The dogs did not come up through Mexico and El Salvador. So we have transmission of these diseases. We have 3 major kissing bug vectors in Texas, and we've been doing some studies now there to show that a significant percentage of them are PCR positive for Trypanosoma cruzi, the vectors. So what about the people? How much of the Chagas disease are we seeing is actually transmitted because of people who are living in severe poverty? Well, we don't know, but one of the reasons that a group of us moved to Texas a year and a half ago from Washington, D.C. to establish this school is to address this hidden burden of neglected tropical diseases in Texas. Christy Murray, who's joined our faculty, has recently done an important preliminary study that's been supported by DNDI, where she found that 14% of a population of 400 homeless people in Houston are seropositive for Trypanosoma cruzi. And most of those were not individuals who are coming up from endemic countries where we think in Latin America. These are these preliminary studies are mostly African American populations living under homeless conditions in Houston. So this is going to be something very important that we feel we need to get our arms around, is the full extent of the transmission of this disease in the U.S. It's not only Chagas disease. Cysticercosis has now become a major cause of epilepsy among the poor in Houston and Texas. We now, Christy Murray with us has now got evidence that we've had dengue transmission in Houston for the last 8 years. It's just that nobody knew about it. And so Houston will probably emerge now as a city with the first major city in North America, first major city in the United States with a major dengue problem. We have West Nile, of course. We have high rates of tuberculosis associated with diabetes in Texas. So we are clearly seeing this kind of level of middle-income country poverty right here in one of the largest states in the United States. So what are we doing about it? Well, we're really desperate to try to get our arms around the full extent of the problem, the true estimate of the number of people that are infected with neglected tropical diseases in the state of Texas and in the rest surrounding southern states. We very much want to design new interventions, and I really appreciate Professor Urbina when you brought up that comment about the importance of persistence of the parasites as opposed to the autoimmunity, because I think this concept of autoimmunity, and I've talked a lot about this with my Brazilian colleagues at Fiocruz and elsewhere who know so much about this disease as well. You know, I think that was been a roadblock for so long because it paralyzed people. It made them want to stop working on the disease because of fear of autoimmunity. It became an excuse, a crutch, not to work on these diseases. So inspired by your work, Professor Urbina and others, we've now undertaken an interesting idea of creating a therapeutic vaccine for Chagas disease based on some proof of concept in mice and in laboratory dogs showing that it's been effective. And we're now doing this through some new support from the Carlos Slim Institute of Health and the Southwest Electric Energy Medical Research Institute. And I hope to have the opportunity to come back in future conversations to talk about these interesting opportunities now to look at not only drugs, but therapeutic vaccines. And maybe what it'll look like in the future is medicines combined with vaccines in some kind of combination, like adjunctive therapy, almost thinking of this like a treatment for cancer. So I think we have an enormously important future ahead of us. We've got this new problem now that I think it has to be addressed of a disease among pregnant women. It's not really a new problem. It's just a newly revealed problem. I think it's been around a long time. I think the same is probably true of Chagas disease in the United States, that this is really maybe not new. In fact, you can find, you can PCR mummified remains from the Rio Grande Valley from 1,500 years ago and find the presence of the parasite. It's just that nobody looked, but I think more importantly, nobody cared to look. And again, this is why Diane, this panel today, and Rachel and Bernard and others, why it's so important that you put on this type of conference in Isabella, because it shows that people really do care, and we can make a big difference in the lives of the world's poorest. Thank you so much.
Peter, thank you very much for those comments. We're now going to move on to our third discussion, which is a slightly broader discussion focusing on vaccines and the approaches of vaccines. And I contrast this to the a sort of initial discussions a decade ago where the entire focus was on drugs. And I think Peter's comments in the last couple of sentences were, I think we need to start thinking about, sort of the holistic approach to this. It may be that we'll have to combine vaccines and drugs, and we need to explore the best kinds of ways. Obviously, there are big advantages to vaccines, but I think drugs will always play a role. And so I think it's very important as we move into this next decade of approaching interventions for infectious, for neglected diseases, that we think about both. And I'm delighted to have both the presenter and the discussant here to talk about vaccines. The presenter is Dr. F. Mark LaForce. He's the Director of Technical Services, the Serum Institute of India. He's going to give an overview of vaccine initiatives.
I want to thank the organizers, DNDI, MSF, and Mount Sinai for asking me to come. This is an important meeting for me personally for a couple of reasons. Number one, the topic is of enormous interest to me personally, and also I'm anxious to see more progress along these lines. What I decided to do when I was asked to do this is to try to put this in some historic perspective rather than trying to take each one of the new antigens, because it just is not enough time in terms of doing all of this. And I wanted to start at the very beginning. All of this, or much of the work in terms of global vaccines, really began in the 60s and the 70s. And it was at the worst time of the Cold War. And really, if you go back historically, the eradication of smallpox was a Russian initiative. The initial presentation to the World Health Organization, the initial support, the initial supply of vaccines really came from Russia. And that program proved to be an enormous success with the eradication of smallpox, and it led to lots of discussions that said, what next? And the what next was the establishment of the Expanded Program on Immunization in 1974. And for those of you who either were there or remember the early days, certainly 75 and 1976, EPI was in office. That was it. And from that, evolved a major global programs that developed national, that emphasized development of national programs and a recommended vaccination schedule for six EPI vaccines that was published in 1984. It's hard to overstate the importance of that step. And then by 1980, there were good enough studies to say that about one half of the world's newborn cohort were at least being not fully protected, but certainly exposed to vaccines. And in 1984, in what I think was one of the most important partnerships, we talk about these partnerships, was the Universal Childhood Immunization, where WHO and UNICEF joined forces with a specific goal, and that is to raise the infant immunization level globally to 80%, a very aggressive and important step. And what's important is that success was celebrated in New York City here in 1990 with the Rights of the Child Summit meeting, which was one of the first, and I think still is, one of the most important meetings that took place in terms of the rights of children to preventive services. And then things went wrong. The wheels sort of came off. And I call this the hangover period. And the hangover period was for about 5 or 6 years. And this is because the achievements in UCI were sort of put together using a lot of external funding, but were unsustainable when that funding fell apart. So that regional coverage in many places either plateaued or fell, and in Africa, they fell very dramatically. And from then on, there were a series of initiatives. Many of you remember those initiatives at WHO that were trumpeted to do this, trumpeted to do that. All of them failed. And they all failed because there was no adequate funding source. And the major transition in all of this occurred quite recently. And this is when the Gates Foundation stepped in and Gavi was created. Gavi, as the Global Alliance for Vaccines and Immunization, provided a new and a generous source of funds to support poor countries and international agencies that were committed to global immunization. And over the next decade and to this day, Gavi has become a game changer. It really has. It has aggressively supported routine programs and the introduction of new vaccines. And this has continued and has proven to be a very attractive source for bringing new money to sustain these global programs. And what new vaccines are we talking about? Remember, EPI started with six antigens. We now have virtually global introduction of hemophilus influenza vaccine and a pentavalent vaccine. The introduction of pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, a group A meningococcal conjugate vaccine, rotavirus vaccine, and HPV as the second cancer-preventing drug, with the first obviously being hepatitis B vaccine. And to show the sort of impact that you may have, I just cite one example, and this is the introduction of the MenA conjugate vaccine, that is for Neisseria meningitidis group A in Niger. These are data from the national laboratory and show numbers of reported cases of acute meningitis from 2008 to 2012, again showing these massive epidemics of group A meningococcal meningitis. Remember that Niger is one of the poorest countries in the world, located directly in the heart of the sub-Saharan meningitis belt. And with the development of an affordable new MenA conjugate vaccine, Vaccination of the entire 1 to 29-year-old population was done in 2010 and in 2011. And this is what happened. These are the group A isolates in the National Bacteriologic Lab. And on the right-hand side, it's the percent of all meningitis isolates, so that you see in 2009 a classic Men A epidemic with 13,000 cases. 97% of the isolates are group A Neisseria meningitidis. After first round of immunization, that went down to 5 cases, and I'm happy to say that this year there were no cases. In point of fact, in the 3 countries that form the heart of what's called the hyperendemic area for group A meningococcal meningitis epidemics, total population of 45 million in Mali, Burkina Faso, and Niger, there was not one single case of group A disease that was documented in that area. That's a sort of a game changer that was possible because of the initiatives that we're talking about. What does the future look like? I'm an incurable optimist, so that I think the opportunities are in place now to translate the 1980 promise of universal access to needed vaccines that was stated in the Rights of the Child Summit, that these promises now can become reality. In short, the future is a bright one unless we mess it up. And I won't go through all of the ways that it can be messed up, but I can assure you, it just begins with big egos and with organizations that feel that they can manage everything. Partnerships are the key to this success, and only time will tell whether we've matured to the level where we can allow these partnerships the chance to succeed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now I think we'll have our discussant, Her Excellency Josephine Ojiambo. She's the Ambassador, Deputy Permanent Representative of the Republic of Kenya to the United States.
Good morning. I'm going to give a narration without the PowerPoints, but at the outset, I just want to acknowledge all of us in the audience, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, and then say thank you to DNDI and MSF for giving me this opportunity to share with you some perspectives from my country, Kenya. I'm delighted to be after Dr. LaForce because I will reflect in terms of context a lot of what he has actually presented, and my context indeed will be Kenya. And as you have heard, I am an ambassador at the United Nations, where I spend a lot of time in the issues and matters of diplomacy, but by initial training, a physician in public health. So for me, it's really a delight to be able to come back to a setting like this, 2.5 years since I came to New York, where I represent my government, at the UN, to contribute to the discussion on progress and shortcomings in a decade worth of international interventions, and focus on addressing poorer populations. And what context do I want to draw in a few introductory remarks? The fact that even at the UN, we worry about disaster and death, and there we think about terrorism and humanitarian disaster, and it's in this context that I work a lot with MSF. But we also speak about non-communicable disease, and we talk about natural catastrophes. In Kenya, this context looks at and reflects on natural disasters such as drought and its effect on refugee populations and the settings where MSF therefore works, but also the issues of viral flu and other communicable disease. I need to just say that massive flu continues to be the singular most disastrous event for the global community, and the flu is a death sentence even in the United States of America, where 36,000 lives are lost annually. And the challenge is that the flu virus continues to mutate aggressively. But I need to say that with globalization, which is an international concern, science and technology can now come together to halt one-fifth of what we know to be preventable disease. And that includes TB, HIV, malaria, flu, and pneumonia. And this is where now we come to the African perspectives. And suffice to say that vaccines are like a whisper. When they work, they create history, and later you can't even hear them. And I must say that because some of you will still have a mark on your upper arm of smallpox, and others will remember the iron lung of polio. But I want to say that vaccine campaigns have made history and eradicated these images from our minds. And so today, we've even forgotten about the heavy toll that those diseases caused. So speaking a little bit about Kenya and Africa, every year millions of African children do not live to see their fifth birthday due to illnesses such as pneumonia and diarrhea, which are top causes of childhood deaths. In Africa, we can't make any strides in ensuring child health without addressing these illnesses, and in particular, pneumonia and diarrhea. And both are preventable through vaccination. Recently, my country, Kenya, proved that it really is at the forefront of administering life-saving vaccines in Africa when our head of state himself launched the pneumococcal vaccine in the country. Today, the free vaccine is administered to all children less than 12 months of age, protecting thousands of children countrywide. Kenya receives the vaccine through Gavi, and my previous speaker spoke about it. This is an innovative financing mechanism called the Advanced Market Commitment. And this mechanism is designed to bring heavily discounted vaccines to children in the world's poorest countries. The initiative is backed by five donor countries: the United Kingdom, Canada, Russia, Norway, and Italy, and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Under this arrangement, Gavi committed initially $40 million to Kenya, and on an annual basis, $35 million towards vaccination. Our government provides $900,000 every year in an incremental manner today towards the same vaccine program. Pneumonia is one of the leading killers of children in Kenya, claiming about 30,000 lives each year. This is a large proportion of the 124,000 under-fived child deaths each year in my country. Therefore, Gavi is highly regarded by the government and the people of Kenya. On the other hand, another leading cause of childhood death, the rotavirus, continues to be addressed in Kenya through the administration of the rotavirus vaccine, Rotatec. The rotavirus is a common cause of severe diarrhea amongst children in Kenya, and the vaccine continues to provide great reduction in childhood mortality. On the 23rd of April last year, our government again reaffirmed its commitment to finding life-saving vaccines by testing the modified vaccine Ankara on 20 Kenyan children. Doctors at the Kenya AIDS Vaccine Initiative that we call CAVI continue conducting studies on the vaccine that's billed to have the most advanced vaccine design ever tested. The efforts towards finding a vaccine and a cure for HIV and AIDS in Kenya have since been boosted by the US President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, PEPFAR, which has helped increase antiretroviral drug access in Kenya. However, the existing prevention, treatment, and care available are still not enough on their own to stop the epidemic. Nonetheless, CAVI, Kenya's efforts, continue to contribute to the development of a desperately needed HIV vaccine, which is a mainstay to stop AIDS once and for all. CAVI has also strengthened the health system in Kenya in many ways. Working closely with our government and with the support of USAID through IAVI, that's IAVI, CAVI has built state-of-the-art laboratories and clinical facilities and trained first-rate Kenyan citizens and technicians for further development of similar vaccines, and that contributes a lot to the health sector. Allow me also to laud the oral polio vaccine program for children in Kenya that has partners from UNICEF and ANIDA to Rotary, to the community and faith-based groups, and to professional groups such as the Kenya Pediatrics Association, represented here by Dr. Fred Were. My country's sequential oral polio campaigns have been successful in reaching zero-free polio communities through the mobilization of diverse actors and stakeholders. These campaigns have tested social mobilization techniques built on community organizations and local leaders, and also carefully designed messages. The oral vaccine that is designed to make less demands on the fragile cold chain systems is easy to administer and demonstrates that vaccine design can ensure compliance and provide cost-effective child survival interventions. While vaccines are very important in improving health and saving lives, the research, manufacture, purchase, and administration of vaccines continues to face challenges. And the previous speaker even said that sometimes they're messed up altogether. Funding continues to be an issue for developing countries like Kenya. And while Kenya is largely dependent on donor funds for vaccination programs, we're making concerted efforts to increase our own capacity in funding vaccination programs and to reduce over-reliance on aid. The experience of the measles initiative in Kenya rapidly enhanced measles coverage by a multi-pronged social mobilization campaign that utilized traditional issues and culture, knowledge gaps in very innovative message design, but also addressed missed opportunities and misinformation, and coupled that with vaccine administration. The campaign was also run alongside the development, as you all know, of the MMR vaccine that has underscored that vaccine administration should be simplified to increase compliance and reduce the number of visits or injections required for a full series of immunizations. Today, efforts in the research and development of a malaria vaccine in Kenya are advanced. You've heard a bit about it. We're in the third phase of the development of this vaccine. As a country, we also now need new and more effective prevention strategies. And more fundamentally, we need to build a sustainable national response to these preventable diseases, such as rotavirus, pneumonia, malaria, and HIV, and grow our country's capacity to develop scientific solutions to our health problems more generally. In this regard, factors such as unstable funding, coupled with humanitarian emergencies, and the fluctuation of the exchange rate of the dollar against our local currency have together caused significant clawback in the success of our vaccine programs. Kenya's future in the prevention of disease by vaccination programs is bright. I echo the previous speaker. I do believe that due to incremental government contributions in the financing of preventive healthcare, innovative funding mechanisms involving the private sector and NGOs, and the participation of the people of Kenya, we'll continue as a nation to lead African efforts in the research and development of life-saving vaccines. And now, just as I conclude, I want to speak a little bit about the African leadership. Suffice to say that the African Leaders Summit, the President's Summit, continues to work towards the Abuja Declaration to commit 15% of GDP to disease prevention, including immunization programs, and that a program called Karma is working to ensure maternal and child health and the health of adolescents, and focuses also on immunization for cervical cancer. So as we end, the issue of production, costs, and time savings in the development of vaccines is important for us. The Secretary General of the UN has launched a new initiative called Every Mother and Every Child that's looking at having vaccines produced on the African continent. I have half a second, I can see. So I'll end by saying that the African continent and here at the UN, we continue to appeal for political goodwill and the financial foresight to invest both in reducing the ravages of preventable disease, through immunizations on the health of the poor and the vulnerable, but also for the same foresight to invest in the continuity of life and the development of the global society. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. All right, I do want to thank all the speakers and thank them keeping to time. And I was under strict instructions from the organizers to keep them to time. So I wanted to leave a few minutes for discussion. We're not going to have quite as much discussion time because we ran a little behind this morning due to technical difficulties. But I want to open the floor to questions. And then we'll ask the panelists to answer them. We have about 15 minutes to do that. Before that, I just wanted to comment. I wanted to thank Dean Philip Landrigan for helping to host this. And I think it's very important that this kind of discussion occur at an academic institution where we are training the leaders of the next generation. And I think it's very important, as he's demonstrated, the collaboration between academic institutions, organizations like MSF, DNDI, and others. This is a very important and I think very important development in the way we think about these diseases. No one organization can solve it, but organizations working together can bring something really spectacular to this space. I think it's important to note that certainly we see it at Harvard a growing interest of undergraduates in the issues of global health, broadly writ, but importantly, I think, wanting to make a difference and wanting to change the world through assessing health as the sort of entry point. And I think that's a very important change. As Dr. Landrigan said, we see this in medical students. But I think it's also very important as we sit in this room to think about how we're going to appeal to students at the business schools, at the faculty of art, in the humanities, to actually bring all of the various disciplines to bear. So I think it's important that we're at an academic institution, academic medical center, and I'm now going to open it to discussion. So the lights are making it difficult to see, but if you have a question, could you come to the microphones or a comment? Do I see anybody? No volunteers. Okay. All right, so why don't I start with a couple, just maybe one question. If each of the panelists could just say what is the one thing in either one word or one very short sentence you'd like to see happen in the next decade. So we'll start. We'll go backwards. So, Ambassador, because you're used to being put on the spot.
Thank you. I think for me and for those with whom I work at the UN, the political goodwill to unlock the health of women and children from the conditionalities of governance, and sometimes what I might state are issues that go beyond the social sector. And number two, sustainable funding for programs in health. Thank you.
Okay.
I would say transparency in the partnerships that are seminal to progress in global public health.
Okay. Peter?
I would say awareness that we have a new global health in front of us, that it's not Kenya versus the United States. It's wherever you find poor people, you'll find neglected diseases. And it doesn't matter if that poverty is in northeastern Brazil, or if it's in Nigeria, or if it's in Kenya or Guatemala, or it's in South Texas or in Houston. Wherever you find extreme poverty is where you're going to find these diseases. And so we need a new awareness. I think that there's a lot of talk about the importance of climate change, and I don't dismiss that, but the awareness that poverty trumps all.
Yeah.
Actually, I have one on each of the aspects I touched. One concerning the prevention. What I would like to see if that the efforts that has been so successful to control the vectorial transmission are sustained in Latin America. Because there is this horrendous mistake saying that because the control of the transmission was effective in Brazil or Uruguay, the problem is solved. That's completely wrong. If those efforts are not sustained, everything is going to roll back to the... So that's from prevention, sustainability of the control programs. The second aspect concerning is the necessity to develop biomarkers for efficacy of treatment in chronic patients. Nobody ever thought about that because it was considered, as I said, that irrelevant to treat chronic patients. But now we know that we have to treat those patients. We find the situation, we don't have really validated biomarkers for that. And finally, I would like our governments to listen to the science and the medicine that tells that everybody has to be treated. In Latin America, the coverage of treatment is horrendously low. It's still less than 1%. And that's a consequence of that previous history of the autoimmunity. Mm-hmm. So only Brazil and Chile have changed their guidelines to include chronic patients. Also, the US now includes the chronic patients. But all other countries exclude chronic patients. And that this is a moral imperative, and it's a human right that these people have to receive treatment, and they are not receiving it. Okay?
Okay. Thank you. Dr. Kamaroff?
Yeah.
I would like to join to what my colleagues have already said here, but I would like to see that during the next decade, we could have a lot of very good, very less toxic, very effective drugs. And I would like to speak for the DRTB, and I would like the progress that we have achieved over the last decade could be translated into new drugs and could be implemented as soon as possible.
It's difficult to add something after my distinguished colleagues, but I will try to answer as a medical doctor. Our main difficulty by now is to diagnose and to treat patients. Our main difficulty is to have the right means to prevent disease. I think that it's very important, it has been mentioned several times, to base our research and development regarding the public health threat. And of course, the threat it will represent for developed countries and for all the countries. But I think that we don't have to stop on that point. It is obvious, on my point of view, that we must center all these approaches on a patient approach. And that what we have to take into consideration by now is the level of suffering and the level of suffering we could alleviate with a proper research and development. And if we do such, I guess that we will tackle quite a lot of disease and preventable means, once again, for the patients, and it will benefit to the public health.
Excellent. Okay, I see two questions, one at the microphone and one here. So could you identify yourself and state your question, please?
Yes. Hi, good morning, everybody. My name is Suri Moon from the Harvard School of Public Health. I'm also a board member of DNDI North America and Médecins Sans Frontières. Doctors Without Borders USA. I was struck by a combination of comments from the panel. First, when we heard about MDR-TB in Uzbekistan, it reminded me that, of course, this is a problem that not only affects Uzbekistan, but in fact is a global problem. At the same time, we were reminded just now by Dr. Urbina that another global problem is the problem of non-communicable diseases, whether neglected or not. And then when Dr. Hota spoke, he reminded us that, in fact, Chagas disease not only affects people in countries like Guatemala or Bolivia, but also here in the United States, particularly some of the most neglected populations. So one of the conclusions that we can draw from the set of comments from the panel is that, in fact, countries are increasingly facing diseases that are common threats, and there are shared interests for countries to collaborate to ensure that there is a sufficient long-term sustainable sources of financing and incentives to invest in R&D, as well as measures to make sure that the benefits of that R&D are in fact shared with all countries. But we're very far away from that today. One of the things that we have not accomplished in the last 10 years is a global framework of rules and norms. We have not managed to establish a global source of sustained financing. We've not managed to come to any political agreement on how we set priorities as a global community or how various countries should contribute to financing or carrying out research. So my question for the panel is, how do we move to a better system that is going to be stronger and more reliable and more equitable than the ad hoc system we have today? Thanks.
Great, thank you. I think we'll take the second question and then we'll hopefully have time for the panel to answer. I would also point out that there are sessions in the rest of the meeting that will deal with some of the issues that were just raised, and so I think that will be a theme going throughout. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. I'm Professor Shamir Brahmachari from India.
Yes.
Dan, I just want to understand, since you are the leader of the world's number one university, how do we make our best mind worry about the problem of the poor and not to do things that only trying to solve problems there's no problem to solve.
Okay, I'll take that after the, do any of the panelists want to comment on the first question? Yes, Dr. Peter, do you want to go first?
Sure. So the first question, boy, there are a lot of different ways you can take that. I think one of the observations with regards to global support for R&D for neglected diseases has come out with the new GFINDER report from Policy Cures, which looks a lot like the last couple of GFINDER reports from Policy Cures, in that it still identifies, as Dr. Fauci says, the U.S. government as the major funder for biomedical research for neglected diseases. But there's some nuance to that, and it's heavily focused on upstream research, to some extent on product development, but not as much as you'd like. And then you get a steep drop off to the other countries, especially European countries, the UK, some of the other European governments, where what I'm seeing, there's a real need to increase the pool is coming from the way Fareed Zakaria calls about in the post-American world, where it's not so much that the U.S. is in decline, although it may be in a couple of weeks, unless something changes, but assuming that doesn't happen, if it's not so much that the U.S. is in decline, it's just that a lot of the emerging market economies have caught up, China, Brazil, India, not only the BRICS countries, but also Mexico, Indonesia, Thailand. And I think these are the nations that now need to make a big push towards becoming global players in supporting neglected disease R&D internationally. We have good representation here, I know, from the Brazilian government that's been very transformational and done a lot of important things with supporting R&D globally. And I'm hoping we'll hear from Carlos Gadelha later about that, maybe later today, about what Brazil is doing, which is extremely innovative and important. But we need this to happen, for instance, in China. China now is investing billions of dollars in sub-Saharan Africa. They have not stepped up to support globally biomedical research for neglected diseases. And China's not alone. Japan has been an underachiever. There have been other underachievers as well. So that's something that we really need to see change.
Okay, Dr. Ojiamba.
I want to appreciate that question, and I want to tie in my response by also bringing back the challenge to the door of the academics and ask that they would initiate a process of review of best practice from country setting so that we can bring to the table what has worked and what has worked effectively, and then assist us to raise the discussion within regions so that we have both regional groupings that are political, because you did mention the political goodwill, but also economic groupings that can support the financing or some of it at regional level, such as the G77 in China, and in Africa, the COMESA, or the South-South collaborative framework that will pull on board Brazil, India, and Mexico, where they're leapfrogging the advancement of vaccine. And also keep in touch with the UN. Today, the buzzword at the UN is post 2015, we seem to be rapidly ending the MDGs discussion, which did have a focus on the poor of the world and ending childhood and maternal disease. If we know that we still need to focus on vaccine, we still need to raise the voice about living up to the commitment of the MDGs before we move into the post 2015 global scenario. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Just one,
because we're sort of running out of time. We have one more question. Yeah. Okay,
Yeah, I just wanted to say concerning the possibilities of expanding the efforts of the endemic regions in Chagas diseases, one natural extension based on the success of the regional initiative on control of vectorial transmission is that now that
this control has been achieved in those countries, the next natural step should be a regional initiative to treat the people that were left behind with the infection. And these regional initiatives could also lead to cooperation between endemic and non-endemic countries. But that's the next natural step, because those people were forgotten because it was considered irrelevant to treat them. Well, they have to be treated, and that previous success of the prevention of the transmission can also be extended to the treatment of those already infected.
Okay, I'm gonna just take one comment over here, just a very quick comment, because we're almost out of time, and then I'll make some very last comments on the role of educational institutions.
This is Elsa Torella, I work with Open Society Foundations, and I have actually a quick question for Dr. Khamarev. On your last slide, you mentioned that there was a real need in your country for to deal with the TB crisis for new drugs and for new tools. And so I was wondering whether that also translates then in a commitment of your government to contribute in the clinical trials that we could start actually tomorrow with the new tools, the new drugs that are in development, and really accelerate the drug development and in a way that has not been done before. And so I wanted to have your thoughts on that.
Dr. Kummer.
Thank you for the question. Obviously, my country is very supportive of all initiatives aimed at improving treatment of patients with this disease. And of course, we are prepared to cooperate in every way to make sure that new drugs are implemented and introduced and used in our country. Probably later on, we could more specifically discuss what we could do together in this area.
All right. Let me just say, to answer the previous question, I'm not, obviously, I'm here in my role as an invitee, and I don't speak for Harvard University, but speaking personally as a scientist in this area and someone who's watched sort of the global health issues evolve in the educational arena, I think it's critically important that educational institutions play a key role in all such disease, treatment, elimination, eradication programs. And what I would say is one of the failings of many of the global health activities, at least in my opinion, have been because a single sector has sort of charged ahead with a vision and without taking into consideration that there might be other outcomes. Think about drug resistance in the case of the malaria eradication campaign of the middle of the last century. And I think it's incumbent upon academic institutions to remain in the conversation, to remain relevant. And I think that by inviting academic institutions and students into the conversation, that will happen. So I am certainly trying to do that at my own institution, but it is clear that global health, I think, is becoming an issue at many academic institutions, and I think that's a very important development and one that this community should encourage. Academics will raise questions, they'll be difficult, they won't always agree with the prevailing wisdom, but that's the role of academics, and I think it's a very important role in this arena. So let me sort of thank all of the panelists and the audience for their patience. I think this has been a very important set of examples, exemplifying many of the issues that we're going to face in terms of neglected diseases. We've seen examples of different diseases and different country settings. And I think it's important, this is, global health is the health of all people, not just people outside the United States. And I think it's very important, and I want to thank all the panelists and the organizers.